Good morning, Tom. Thank you for joining me. You're General Manager at Sika UK. Can you just tell me a little bit about what your job entails?
Yeah, absolutely. So my role is to lead the senior management team. I have 10 individuals on that team covering all the disciplines of the company. And my job is to make sure that I give them a vision, a leadership, and we deliver the goals and the targets we set. My main focus really is to make sure that the staff are safe and well. And especially in these times with the pandemic, that we manage that in the correct manner. Within the UK, we have a number of companies under the Sika umbrella, and really trying to integrate them so that we become one Sika, one Sika UK. That's really my main job.
Sika is a global business. Could you tell me a little bit about the countries that Sika operates in and maybe some of the market sectors?
Yeah, absolutely. So, pretty much everywhere in the world, there is the Sika companies or the certainly Sika products out there. We work in what we call target markets, and we have 8 target markets that we look after, and they go through the concrete and waterproofing, engineered refurbishment, flooring and roofing, ceiling and bonding industry, and then we have a large part of our products go through distribution. So in the UK, we have a company called Everbuild. And clearly that's a large part of our business. And that little Sika triangle really is a stamp of quality. It means that we can be trusted, and that's our logo, is building trust, and that's really important. And even if we don't have a country that's operating with production facilities, we've probably got some representation through a distributor there. So it is very much a global business.
Sustainability is what we're here to talk about today. So sustainability has never been so important, and it is a global topic. Have your views on understanding and the issues of sustainability changed over the past few years?
Absolutely. If we went back maybe 10 years ago, sustainability was mentioned and people were thinking, how do we do it? Today's very different. There's a momentum built out there. Lots of organisations are really looking at what they can do and what's feasible. And the government at last seems to be taking it seriously. There's lots of good initiatives, but it's like anything. Do you take it seriously? Do you really want to make a commitment? Sika is a global company. The answer is quite simply yes. The focus from our main board is very much that sustainability is a key part of our strategy. We inform our shareholders in terms of what our targets are, and we're really trying to make a difference. Very simple way to do that is the entire management team in the UK is all bonus. Sustainability is part of our bonus structure, and that's to make sure that it's front and centre, and we have to do it.
Do you think we're at a tipping point now whereby probably in sort of previous years we've had sort of a minority having the voice around sustainability, and we're now getting to a much larger audience in terms of those that understand the importance and therefore accelerating change?
Yeah, probably in the last 12 months in particular, there's been a real ramp up. We're part of the CPA. We obviously sit on committees regarding what's going on within the wider industry. We're part of the Green Building Council. The government, who have set lots of targets, the key really is, are we going to meet those targets? Are we going to drive them forward? Are we going to set ambitious targets? And we really have to, because you have to push, because you might set a range of targets. How many are you going to hit? So if they're ambitious and we have enough of them, we make a difference. We need everybody in the world to do this. And that's where the real key players, we need the powerhouses of the United States and China and Russia. Everybody's got to come to the table on this one.
I understand that Sika's got a sustainability strategy entitled More Value, Less Impact. Mm. What's the purpose of this initiative?
Yeah, so it's very simple. We are looking at everything we can possibly do in terms of developing new products for the future. Every new product development is very much focused on what is the sustainability impact of that product. Whilst it's difficult and challenging, all our research and development teams are working and focused on that. A global level, we have targets, 25% of all new products have to have those sustainability targets achieved. But it's not just that, it's what we can do as a business. So again, we're moving the fleet over to electric cars. We've installed charge points at our sites, that's happening at the moment. We're installing solar panels in our sites, again, trying to reduce our energy bill. We're also looking at what we can do in terms of where we buy our energy from. Can we buy it from those who provide a more green energy, you know, a recyclable energy? But we're in a place now, what we do for the next 10 years really sets the scene for what our world's going to be like for our children and our grandchildren. It's really important we get this right. I'm passionate about it. Sika as a global company is passionate about it. We've got to make a difference. And we just hope other companies follow suit and go with us.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're right. It is a shared responsibility, and I always refer to the phrase that's, you know, if you have the ability, you've got the responsibility. And clearly Sika, you know, has that ability to facilitate change, and that's what you're looking at doing.
Oh, absolutely sure. We have somebody whose total responsibility is on sustainability, and that looks external, with all our customers, and the environment, the various companies that we engage with, the standards, the committees, things like that. But we also look internal. What can we do? Everything we can do, we can actually put that filter on there. Right, let's do it differently. And that's what it's about. It's about doing it differently.
Your sustainability strategy focuses on six strategic areas. There's sustainability solutions, climate performance, community engagement, energy, water and waste, and occupational safety. Are any of these more important than the others, or are they all as equal in terms of priorities?
What we have to look is this in the round. So it's a holistic view. If we focus on one area, that's great for having that one focus and we can achieve something. But if we look at things from a more wider perspective, I think that gives us a much more balanced view. Clearly, as we see what is possible, there'll be different sort of timescales. So things we can do immediately, that's fantastic. But there's also things we have to do next year, the year after, or in 10 years' time. So when we set targets, we've got to be sensible. What is achievable? What can be done?
And I think that's right. You were saying about making those targets and what's achievable. Actually, if this was easy, we'd all been doing this years ago. It's not easy.
It's not easy. No, it's absolutely not easy. The challenge is, how do you change something that's been constructed and built and developed over 100 years, Sika's over 100 years in terms of operation. We have to change hearts and minds. We have to get people to understand the impact of sustainability, what it's doing for not just us as people, but also, you know, our community, our country, you know, the world. Some people will embrace it, some will be resistant, and it's our job to lead and to actually convey that message that this is incredibly important.
So the government has set a target of building 300,000 new homes a year. In addition to that, we have a target to be net zero by 2050. Are we being too ambitious, or is it good to have targets?
Absolutely, we have to set ambitious targets. If you get 90% of your target, you've made a real difference. I think you'll find that the vast majority of companies really want to try and make a difference. The government's got its part to play, and they've got to be bold, and they've got to lead, and they've got to encourage, and they can do that because they control a lot of the spend.
So in terms of, you know, supporting businesses to help make that change, we have these ambitious targets, but we're also facing a national skills shortage. In addition, we are going through a material shortage, which I'd like to think is potentially a short-lived shortage. How are we going to address those issues as well?
This is probably the most challenging time for any manufacturer. Every day is a new challenge. We have a different raw material or selection of raw materials being unavailable. Material doesn't turn up when it's supposed to. I think we're in for the rest of this year for a fairly bumpy ride. But using our R&D capabilities, we've been able to find alternative materials. We've used our sort of regional and global reach. So we're bringing in materials from the Far East, we're bringing it in from the Americas, we're bringing it in from Australia and New Zealand. So there's lots of things we can do, but it is a real challenge. It will slow down towards the end of the year, and we will get a little bit of a respite, and hopefully next year will be much better.
What is Sika doing to help address sort of skills and trying to encourage young people into the industry?
We can have the best products, you know, with the greatest degree of certainty that these products will do the job. The workmanship and the application is really key, and that's why we put the efforts into training. We have training programs on all our sites. We do a lot of virtual training these days because we've had to adapt. So we normally have an intake of interns and apprentices. We're looking to substantially increase that because we have to make sure that we've got that skill gap covered, and we're encouraging everybody else to do the same. You know, we have to invest in the future, and if we don't do these training programs, it will be real tough in order for us to actually achieve what we want to achieve.
I touched on the fact that we've got a target of 300,000 new homes a year. The UK's got something like 45 million existing buildings. By focusing on these new homes, are we sort of missing the point about we've got an awful lot of existing buildings that are below par in terms of, you know, thermal performance and sort of quality? Mm. And actually, you know, how are we going to go about refurbishing this building stock?
Yeah, so I think you're right. In terms of the new build, I think there's great opportunities to use the latest technology, to use, you know, everything we can to make it a more green and sustainable home. For the refurbishment area, again, we have lots of systems, we have lots of newer products which are more sustainable in terms of that refurbishment. We've got the technology that we can actually move into SIM-free, or we can have a hybrid between the two. And again, that's where the R&D is so really important, that we have these newer systems which are more environmentally friendly, so that when we do refurb, we can actually make a positive impact on that particular area and refurb without that sort of damage that we can do with some of the more older systems which are based on sort of traditional cements.
Some of the sort of flagship sustainable buildings are either small developments or one-off buildings. How do we start taking sustainability across sort of the mass market into a, you know, much larger scale? You know, do things like off-site sort of play into that?
I think first things first is the government has to play its part. Now they have tried to promote, and certainly when they're doing public realm, they are doing everything they can to encourage that. The reality is they need to do more. They also need to make sure that the message is spread that we are serious in achieving these goals. The reality is we've got to embrace technology, we've got to embrace innovation, and by doing that we can create a more sustainable project, a more sustainable solution, and obviously less impact to the environment. We've got to have this balance between the cost of the project and the environmental impact, and actually that's where the focus has to be.
Yeah, you mentioned cost there, that's interesting. Sustainability, it's going to cost more?
Yes and no. So there will be times that absolutely sustainability solutions will be more expensive, but not always. There'll also be a time where we can offer something which is equivalent cost. So I think it's one of those things, there is no rule. It will depend on that particular application and what the situation is. And of course, the more we develop the technology and the systems that are more green, the more then that becomes more cost effective.
And do you think that maybe we're still a little bit hung up at unit cost at day one, rather than cost of building in use and life cycle, and also the value of the asset that we've created?
Yes, absolutely. If we take the vehicles, for instance, you know, when we made the decision to go from petrol and diesel to electric, we were doing whole life costings because, you know, if you look at it purely on your monthly charge, well, this is more expensive for us. But if you take the whole life costing, actually it's either the same or maybe even a little bit less. And that's exactly the same for either new build or for refurbishment. You have to look at the whole life costings. You know, build better. You know, that's one of the government's phrases, and I know it's about levelling out, but actually build better is actually to be smart what you're doing. And if you are smart in how you construct and you use the newer technologies and you use that and embrace better technology and better systems, the savings are there, which then actually means you could use a different product which is more sustainable, but your original budget can be met. So it's a mind shift. That's what we need.
I understand you recently countersigned a letter to Prime Minister Boris Johnson, a letter from the UK Green Building Council around the planning bill. Could you tell me a little bit about that letter and why you agreed to countersign that?
The government may have a rhetoric in terms of we really want to make a difference, but ultimately they've got to deliver on that difference. So when I read the content of the letter, I agreed with every word that was in there. And so it was a simple case of don't give us the rhetoric, actually deliver on it. I think we had over 100 companies sign the letter, which is great. I wish it had been 200 or 500. But if you don't try and make a difference and you don't lobby for these things, nothing will ever change.
So one final question to you. Later this year, it's the COP26, the UN's climate change conference being held in Glasgow. If there was one outcome that comes from this year's COP26, what would you like that to be?
I would really like the UK to lead and really set very ambitious targets, something that actually shocks people. That would be really good. And probably I'll take a second one there. If the rest of those participants do the same, that would be an amazing thing and will make a difference. I would rather have everybody on board, everybody trying to achieve it, and everybody realizing that actually the clock's ticking. We've literally got less than 10 years to make this change in our view and also deliver it. And if we don't start at that COP26, that will be a real bad day for the world, really.
Tom, thank you very much.
My pleasure.